Hi friends, this is Pete, call sign K7PP, and I thought we'd kind of take a trip down memory lane, looking at an old Johnson Viking Valiant transmitter, built back in the late 50s, and a lot of us have some pretty nice gear. I know I've got my share of Japanese-made ICOM and Kenwood equipment. But I also have the old boat anchor Hammerland and Johnson pair that I use for AM. And it just occurred to me that a lot of the functions on these old transmitters are kind of lost in today's terminology. In other words, there are things on this transmitter that you don't see on new equipment and would never see. So consequently, when people start buying these and restoring them, which a lot of people are doing, what do the controls actually do and what do they mean? So I thought we'd take a few minutes and actually look at the equipment and look at the drawings and see if we can't sort it out. So we're looking at specifically things like the exciter control, the final power adjustment control, the drive control, clipping perhaps, loading. We're looking at band switches, mode switches, and meter switches, as well as the variable frequency oscillator. So I thought what we'd do is just walk through the drawing, the diagram, and see what these controls do and what they actually refer to. So I have a drawing or a diagram. Probably a lot of you are very familiar with schematic diagrams, otherwise you wouldn't be looking at this. And I'll just kind of go through them bit by bit here and explain where the signal path is and what's going on. We're looking at a vacuum tube oscillator, which generates the actual radio signal. And this oscillator tube is a 6AU6. It's a miniature tube, 7-pin miniature, and it's arranged in a Colpitts oscillator. You can always tell a Colpitts because it uses a unique arrangement of center-tapped capacitors. So there are your two capacitors. And you'll also notice that this is configured also as an electron-coupled oscillator, which means that the feedback point doesn't come off the plate of the tube. The feedback actually comes off the grid, or the, in this case, the cathode. And here's our feedback point, back through the band switch and back up to the center tap. So that's what actually maintains the oscillation. And also the fact that since the plate circuit is completely divorced from the circuit as far as interaction with the device that is actually resonating, it makes the oscillator very stable. And to enhance the stability, here's another miniature tube that is a gas-fired voltage regulator tube. In this case, an OA2. It regulates to 150 volts, just like a gigantic neon bulb. And the signal, the resulting signal, is coupled over to a buffer amplifier, which further enhances the stability of the oscillator because the buffer amplifier simply amplifies the signal presented to it. And anything that happens downstream can't be reflected back into the oscillator, primarily because it's electronically coupled and primarily because of the voltage regulation. So the resultant signal coming out of the buffer amplifier is passed through to a tank circuit. And that tank circuit is then sent through a band switch, and that in turn is sent to a multiplier stage, in which case sometimes the actual signal is doubled or tripled before, frequency-wise, before it's sent on to the power amplifier. And here's where we're getting into the adjustment phase of the equipment. If we're looking at the exciter control, we're referring to this multiplier stage. The multiplier stage has a tuning capacitor, which is the actual control on the front, and there are tapped coils that go down to the band switches, and the band switches allow you to pick the band at which you wish to resonate and tune. So depending upon where the band switch is adjusted, any part of this coil may be excluded or included into the resonance circuit. This capacitor then would adjust for resonance, and once it is adjusted for resonance, power would be coupled out of this circuit through these capacitors and into the grid circuits of the 36146 alpha vacuum tubes, which are our power amplifiers. And you'll notice another capacitor here. This is simply a capacitor used for neutralization. These vacuum tubes all have inter-electrode capacitances because they're actually wires suspended in free space and next to each other, so they have an inherent amount of capacitance. And that inherent amount of capacitance will tend to couple a signal through the tube as an unwanted signal and cause the tubes to self-oscillate. So what they do is they take a little bit of signal from the plate circuits and they bring it back through a capacitor to adjust the amount of signal, and then they reinsert it at the bottom of the resonant coil, which puts it 180 degrees out of phase, which cancels out effectively the inner electrode capacitance of the grid versus the plate circuit. So neutralization capacitor. So anyway, make a long story short, when you adjust your exciter, you're adjusting the maximum coupled output out of this stage into the power amplifier, and you can further fine-tune that with the drive control. There is a potentiometer on the front of the radio that is listed as drive, and that simply adjusts the amount of voltage on that tube's screen grid, and that determines the amount of actual output that comes out of the circuit and goes into the final tubes. And to further illustrate that, if I were to switch on the circuit here and look at my grid drive, I'm going to turn the drive control up or down. In either direction, I can select the amount of grid drive going to the final power amplifier. If I reach over here and grab the exciter control, I can peak it for resonance, and as I approach resonance, I'm going to see an increase in efficiency and power that's coupled into the final power amplifier. Consequently, when we tune for power output out of the amplifier, we're going to be using the final power tuning control, which is essentially the same thing and is represented by plate current. The metering switch allows me to monitor plate, grid, or buffer signals to let me know what's happening inside the equipment. Our grid drive and our plate. We don't have any plate current right now because we're not pressing down the push to talk, but when we do, same drill. We would dip the plate, which would increase the power going up to the antenna. I can read the power going to the antenna by coming over here to a watt meter, and everybody probably recognizes this as a Bird watt meter. So consequently, if I were to key the transmitter at this point, there's nobody on frequency. It would help if I put all the switches in the right position and nobody on the frequency, and I would key and I would see about 140 watts of power output. If I come over here and take a look at my meter, 140 watts of power can be derived by dipping the final power amp. And that's what I'm doing right here. I'm dipping by turning the final control, and it's about 320 milliamperes for approximately 140 watts of power output. So anyway, hopefully this is going to be of assistance in understanding what it is we're doing when we're actually turning these specific controls. And we'll have more of these little schematic discussions, because a lot of these radios are turning up and a lot of the fellows are trying to get them restored and put back into good operating condition. And I kind of think it's my responsibility to share whatever it is I know, so that people can enjoy these radios and continue to give them a little extension as far as their lifetime goes. They're really well made and should last another 50 years. Thanks a lot. Appreciate you looking, and we'll be back with more info a little later. This is Pete, K7PP.